You're listening to the Worldwide Sports Radio Network.
Painkiller.
CJ the Painkiller.
Kevin Jackson.
So we need to start acting like a big boy football. It's time for the jet tax to die.
Whoa! You're listening to Weapons Hot on Sports War Radio and the Worldwide Sports Radio.
There's one into the end zone. It is caught. That's a jet touchdown.
And now here is your host, Jay the Painkiller, DeSimone, and Kevin Jackson.
What's going on, Jets Nation? Welcome to another edition of Weapons Hot, a New York Jets fan broadcast here on the Worldwide Sports Radio Network, Sports War Radio, Snowman Digital Media, and quite frankly, any place where you can get your New York Jets fan fix. I'm your host, CJ the Painkiller DeSimone, and as you can see by our panel, we have a very special guest here tonight, so I'm not wasting any time. It's time to introduce the squadron, ladies and gentlemen, and you know who's up next.
Are you going to do that to me?
Ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together for the man, the myth, the legend, Mr. Kevin Jackson! Jax, what's going on, brother?
Man, another episode of Weapons Hot, my man. I'm telling you right now, I'm so amped. We're ticking down to the draft. We're outside of that ridiculous-ass period of time that we call silly season, and now we're starting to get into some serious football. Even though there's, you know, there's kind of some stuff that's floating around is still questionable. We're now getting to a point in time where reality is getting ready to set in for some of these folks. Look, I'm really excited about our guests. I say that almost every week, but real talk tonight. Oh yeah, I'm ready to get it in. Weapons Hot. Let's go.
All right, it's now time to introduce, ladies and gentlemen, from the top secret bunker all the way in Idaho. Put your hands together for Jimmy the Reaper Jardine.
OER is entertainment.
All right, so Jimmy, talk to me. What's going on, brother?
I love that part.
Oh, man, we are about to get into some good stuff, guys. I can't wait. I love our new guest. I can't wait to chat with him and to kind of clear some things up.
All right. Yeah, we can't wait either. All right. Now, our rookie test pilot's in the house, ladies and gentlemen. Put your hands together for Harrison, the Fireball Glazer. Fireball, what's going on, brother man?
Oh, man, I'm good. Always so happy to be here. Love being part of the Weapons Hot podcast, one of the best podcasts out there. This is great. Like everyone said, we have an awesome guest here tonight. Can't wait to get into it. Always love talking about those Jets, so let's get it going.
All right, and I've got some very special music queued up for our guest, because you know what? You know you have not been introduced until you get a Weapons Hot introduction.
Period, point blank. Let's go.
And here we go. And gentlemen, put your hands together for Daniel Bien-Aime. Daniel, welcome to the show. How are you tonight, my friend?
I'm doing good. Thanks for having me on. You know, let's get into it. You know, we got a lot of things to talk about. It's going to be fun.
Heck yeah, absolutely. So, Daniel, really quick, this is obviously your first time here on Weapons Hot, which, by the way, we cannot thank you enough for sparing a few minutes tonight to come and hang out with us. Please tell us a little bit about yourself.
Well, you know, from Miami, Florida. I'm actually down here right now, down by Biscayne, close to South Beach, but I'm from Miami, Florida. I'm about 26 years old, turned 27 in December.
That's awesome.
What else? I used to play football a little bit in high school and a little bit in junior college. Wasn't great, wasn't good, low average about that. But I was a track athlete. What I did, you know, I was fast, though. So I probably got into a track career a little bit. Got a D1 scholarship to run track at the University of Louisville. Ooh, spent some time there, about 2 years there. 2016-2018. After I graduated, got into writing. I started covering Louisville athletics to start off. Parlayed that into a admission into the Columbia Journalism School. Went there for about a year, graduated during the pandemic. And, you know, had one quick stint down in St. Augustine, Florida, about 45 minutes south of Jacksonville.
Nice.
Here I am now. And
yeah, I'm about an hour and a half away from St. Augustine, where I live in Florida.
Oh, where exactly? Where exactly do you live in Florida?
I live in Palm Bay, which is in Brevard County on the Space Coast.
Okay. St. Augustine, their girls basketball team just played Palm Bay in the Final Four. Palm Bay destroyed them. Oh my God! It was I got there like a little bit after the first quarter. You know what I'm saying? I got there like it was like 2 minutes left because I was running late, and it was like I think like 11-7 or something like that. And in that second quarter, because Palm Bay, they have this one girl that's like 6'2", shooting like Klay Thompson. She was out there wetting things left and right, and I was just. Before I knew it was a blowout. I think they lost like 60 to like 30 something or something like that. And I was just like, dang. It's what it is, though.
Awesome.
Yeah, that's small world, though. Small world.
Definitely. Absolutely.
Except for me, I'm out here like across the country from you.
Yeah, I was about to say, I'm in Georgia, so, you know.
Okay.
But look, born and raised in New York. Born in New York. Spent a few years there. Went to California. Played some decent high school football in California. Came back.
What part of California?
Ooh, Long Beach. I played at Long Beach Polytechnic High School. I played with, matter of fact, I played with Willie McGinnis, Ed Cavs. There was a few guys that were there, you know, just when I came in that, you know, really made some noise. If you got to go to the Wikipedia page, you'll see, you know, my high school was pretty. It was impressive. I don't brag on that because I didn't build it, but
I
played there.
I bragged that I played corner at Capital High School.
Okay.
Where Jake Plummer went. I was like, he just left when I was in there, but.
We wouldn't have enough time to go through all the guys that came through my program.
I'm just going to. Oh, Mr. California.
Look, Deshaun Watson.
He's got the weight down.
Juju. I mean, for real, though. Look, Omar Stoutmire, all them guys. Yeah, I'm going to stop now, but yeah.
Weird flex, but okay, Kev. Weird flex.
Anyways, right. Daniels, it's great to have you, man. I know we got some questions. I know CJ's going to run through it. I personally am excited about having you. I'm sure we'll get into this a little bit later on in the show, but you have some big shoes to fill. We'll just throw it out there. Obviously,
yeah, I'm all right. Yep, you feel me?
I would imagine you have to be. How could you not take this job without understanding that? So you just got some questions though, bro. So we'll go ahead. We'll get started, and you know we're gonna make sure that we have enough time to get you all in tonight.
All right.
Absolutely. All right. So my next question for you is: what is it that made you decide to be a beat writer in the first place? Was it something you aspired being, or did you kind of just kind of fall into it?
So that's a really, really good question. I think when I first graduated from the University of Louisville, I did a radio internship my junior year in 2017. So I got I got a little taste of that, but I didn't really learn much. But after I graduated, I started doing radio a little bit, and I kind of wanted to be the guy that's breaking stories versus just reacting to the story.
Yep.
You know what I'm saying? Like, if let's say Sam Darnold were to get traded tomorrow, I wanted to be the guy that could break that story versus like hopping on the radio and talking about, you know, blah, 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 just reported that this happened. I wanted to be the reporter. I kind of was, drawn to it by that. Because initially, my mentor, he wanted me to look into, like, being, like, an on-air TV guy. But I just couldn't get past, like, the whole looking into a camera and talking into it with a set piece of what you got to say and things like that. I just wasn't really comfortable with that because when I had been groomed for that. I enjoy writing. And, I feel like when you write, everything you put out into the ether will stay there, you know? So if I I've thought about doing like a column saying the Jets should draft Justin Fields, but I also know that if I put that out and let's say they go with Zach Wilson and Zach Wilson becomes a star and Justin Fields goes to wherever he goes and he becomes
Atlanta,
you know what I'm saying? Let's say he becomes a bust, that column will be put under, people are going to attach that to my name.
Right.
Like, you know, oh, you don't know what you're talking about, blah, 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 blah. You wrote this. And I kind of, like, am driven by that. And I actually want that type of pressure. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
So I think that's what drove me is you know, is the ability to be one, be able to be held accountable, hold people accountable with articles that I can write. And, you know, I enjoy writing. You know, just putting thoughts to paper that can really stick and be there for, you know, the long term.
Nice.
Very nice.
That's awesome, man. Yeah. I totally like feel you, you know, because I'm like, I get everything you're saying because, like, right. I'm a big writer too. Like, that's how I started out. Like, I was just writing and, like, doing, like, independent writing, poetry and stuff like that. And then I just love sports and met a couple people, started doing sports writing. And, yeah, it's turned into more stuff. But for me, it always started with the writing. So I love that answer, man.
Yeah, and, yeah, for sure.
I write for TruthSerumFootball.com. It's, like, not jet specific, but I do – NFL as a whole, because I'm very numbers driven. I'm very salary cap driven, how contracts kind of work into all that stuff. So yeah, same here, man. I love just diving into something. I love being able to explain something that your casual NFL fan doesn't understand. Like, how does a contract work into the salary cap? Or, like, how does Dak Prescott get $75 million, but it only counts as $22 million to the cap this year? Like, that's the type of stuff that I love to just deep dive into.
I write for health information management professors these times, so I've got three papers due this week, so still in school, man. Let's go.
So shout out to Jose Gomez, who's been commenting on
Jose.
The NY Jets fans and Greenhouse Jets football pages over there with laughing emojis and an OxyClean GIF saying, "But wait, there's more." So thank you. We appreciate the, you know, we appreciate the love, the love and the support from, you know, from the couch potato factory here guy? Over here. So
he's gonna be that guy this week, huh?
Right, exactly. So
is this where you want to be when Jesus comes back?
So
Jimmy's turning this whole thing around.
I'm saying, look,
right.
Sometimes
you 180.
Gotta, yeah. Sometimes you got to set them on fire, man. Sometimes you got to set them on fire. Cut it out.
All right. So DJ, I got it. I actually have a couple more questions for you. Every reporter has a figure that inspires them to be a reporter. Who do you figure was your inspiration to become a writer or a reporter?
I believe, let me think, give me a second. I think that inspired me, probably like a blend of Rob Parker, Stephen A, and a little bit, just a drizzle, not too much. Because you can't have too much skip. If you got too much skip, you go insane.
Exactly.
But those three for sure, and as I've gotten older, you know, I've read, but those three for sure. Just, you know, their fearlessness, for the most part, you know, but seeing them on TV, I'm thinking like, oh, how do you get to that spot? So I used to think, you know, obviously you could do that through radio or whatnot, blah, 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 blah. But come to find out, they are all beat reporters at one point. And, you know, like, you know, them being able to have strong takes and being able to put that to pen and be fearless about it. You know, you got to be able to write things that, you know, you can live with whatever the backlash is going to be. And be good with that, you know.
Right.
When I look at it, you know, I had a lot of Jets fans, you know, when I first got on the gate. You gotta watch out for Jets Twitter. I'm like, oh man, I'm a grown man. Whatever they got to tweet at me, tweet at me, and I'm gonna lock my phone and go about my. That's it. You know what I'm saying?
So right.
You
know,
and then the first day.
Exactly, you know what I'm saying? So you know their fearlessness, you know, that just kind of, you know, I kind of copied that in a sense, because, you know, I've been in situations where, you know, whatever I write, that won't compare to when I'm in junior college and I got to run certain times so I can get a scholarship. Because if I don't get that scholarship, I don't know how I'm going to be able to pay for school. I don't know how I'm going to be able to go to school. I don't know what's going to happen, blah, 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 blah. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Where your back is really up against the wall, or where, you know, I graduated from Louisville and I'm trying to figure out how am I going to be able to, you know, pay these bills. How am I going to be able to find a job? How am I going to be able to take out my dog that I had at the time, pay for rent, things like that. Like, those real life situations, I'm like, man, this ain't nothing. Okay, You think I'm a clown? You think I'm an idiot? Cool.
Whatever.
Enjoy your day, brother.
Right.
About mine.
Whatever, man.
So their fearlessness, you know, just seeing how they went about their fearlessness, I just, you know, that's what kind of I look to and I try to emulate that into how I write now.
I think I was one of those first tweets. I think it was. And hey, I'm willing to have the conversation. I think I tweeted something about first impressions and all. I think it was the, hey, I'm a Miami fan.
And
I was like, yo. You're coming to the concrete jungle, brother. Like,
I'm thinking that being a Miami fan, or excuse me, being a Jets fan actually isn't a prerequisite for taking a job. But the answer that you just gave about being a more objective in how it is that you write, I think that's going to be a big deal for us. The Jets have been starving, bro. I mean, as a Miami fan, I'm sure you know, it's not like you haven't been in close proximity to what's been going on with us. I guess my question is, just looking from the outside coming in and recognizing what has just recently changed with the organization, how do you feel about the position that you're in going forward right now with this team, though? And with what it is that you've seen, could you actually see yourself being a little bit more, drawn towards what's going on with this organization now going forward?
So being in this position, it's kind of like a clean slate. I'm coming in when there's a whole new staff. So that's a positive.
Yes. I will say that.
Yeah, that's a positive. Yes. Because, I knew some beat reporters down in Miami that, they weren't really too fond of Adam Gase. So, just being able to come in this situation, not have to worry about having to cover Adam Gase, that's a plus.
That's a prerequisite. Not liking Adam Gase. You couldn't have the job without not liking Adam Gase.
You just made a lot of Jets fans.
Yeah, you can't like Adam Gase and have this job.
So, just being able to come in this position, I feel like, it's a great spot to, because, I've heard a lot of people talk about my predecessor, the person that came before me, and how negative he was. So the bar is in a sense kind of low. All I gotta do is be a normal human being and people will appreciate that.
Right. Don't be stalking the coaches and the GM's kids and you're good to go.
Right. You know what I'm saying? So I feel like, there were some, issues that the New York Daily News had, but I can't do nothing about that at the end of the day. All I can do is control how I go about my business, do job to the best of my ability. Because that's what Charles did. Charles was in a very bad situation, but he still did it to the best of his ability, and he was able to parlay that into something better.
Yeah.
Now he can just cover the NFL from a national perspective. You know what I'm saying? So that's how I approach my job. And seeing what the Jets are doing now with some of the moves that they've made out of some free agency with the Corey Davis or the Carl Lawson pickup, with the Robert Saleh pickup, things like that, I feel like the direction that the Jets are going in is a really, really good situation and a good scenario. I think the reason why, the teams in AFC East are starting to get their stuff together is because Tom Brady's gone. So it's like, all right, fine. He's gone. Now we can finally get our stuff together, Because Bill Belichick and Tom Brady,
that was
20 years of
this. glad they're gone.
It's a fake dynasty, guys. Okay, the Pats is a fake dynasty, and I'll go to my grave saying.
I wish I could take them rings that they had that was fake, though. I'd drop all of that.
Why?
How are you going to claim a dynasty when, the Bills perennially bad, the Jets perennially bad, the Dolphins perennially bad, in that time frame, right? So how are you going to be like, we're the greatest ever, when you're guaranteed a playoff spot, you're guaranteed a bye week, you're guaranteed all that stuff going into the playoff? Fake dynasty, man. And Tom Brady's career was built on a lie and a bad call, so I don't even want to hear about any of that.
I knew he was coming out with that. All right, so listen, before we start taking out the bazookas and the tanks and everything for this poor man, all right, I've got one major question that I really want to ask you, and I want to make sure I get this one in. What was your reaction for being the beat writer for one of the most passionate and most opinionated fan bases in the NFL? Were you apprehensive, or do you see it as a challenge?
Far from apprehensive. I don't even see it as a challenge. I just see it as sports. Just from my experience of having been an athlete, you know, that type of environment of just ultra-competitive human beings, I'm like, all right, this ain't nothing new to compare to, like, you know, me going and competing in the ACC and having to run against dudes that eventually competed in the Olympics and stuff like that. So I just look at it, you know, just people loving their sport. I mean, you know, I prefer that versus, you know, no disrespect to high school. Like, I love the high school kids I was working with, you know what I'm saying? But it ain't like, you know, if I make a mistake on a tweet, I don't have to worry about people, like, coming at my neck about me making a mistake. It kind of keeps me on my P's and Q's, but you know, be you scared of that? Nah, I can't be scared of that. I don't see it as a challenge. I just see it as a reality. It's like, all right, just roll with the punches. So.
Nice.
Yeah. Okay. As good of an answer as that is, just be prepared because Jets fans will come at you if you make a mistake.
But DJ, based on like all the answers you've given so far, it seems like everything is, you know, but based on the fact that, you know, like, you're going to be true to yourself. You're going to be how you want to be.
Do it how you're supposed to be, though.
And yeah. I think that's awesome. Like, I just want to say, like, if anyone could give you the best advice, like, that's it. And you already have it, which is awesome. Yeah. Like, that's how you want to approach it. And, you know, from, like, my own perspective, like, I do Jets takes. And, you know, when you only half the people are going to agree with you half the time. And as I started to get bigger, I got, oh, my God, the amount of shade I would get and, like, the stuff I would get. And at the beginning, it took a little while to adjust to. But, yeah, that's, like – that's the best thing you can realize, you know, just be true to yourself, say what you want to say. And well, if people don't like it, they don't like it. Some will.
So like the other day I made a mistake. Like I was talking about the offensive line and I put that, I put Alex, cause you know, at left guard, I said, you know, left side is solid. You got Mekhi Becton, you got Alex Lewis, but I put Alex Smith by accident. He was like, oh, he put Alex Smith. Well, this I just right. I'm like, damn, I made that mistake. All right, cool. Go fix that. All right, Vic. All right, let me go up. My feet up and go watch some TV. Like, look, you know what I'm saying? Like, that's that. You know what I'm saying? I think one thing that allowed me to be more prepared for this opportunity is, and like, you know, that aspect of the job is like watching how other people handled it. You know, just seeing how, like, no matter what, there's going to be people coming at you on both sides, no matter what it is. Whether it's sports, politics, religion, it don't matter. No matter what, there's going to be two sides of the coin. So you just got to, you know, understand that, you know, there are people that support what you're saying, people that will disagree. And at the end of the day, you're going to be just fine.
Yeah. And, like, you know, that's the whole point. Like, I always tell myself, you know, with journalism, it's you want to do that. Like, you're supposed to create a conversation and create a narrative. So if you're getting people talking, even if they don't like what you're saying, there's still a conversation happening because of that.
Exactly. That. Yep. I 110% agree with that.
Man, this is awesome. Okay.
All right. As we start off already with some of the questions, the comments have just completely blown up over here. Shout out to Lino Cortino, who's watching us from work. Scott Cleesby, who's watching. Ryan Barger's watching. Rockaway Archie is out there. Let's see. Garen Brower Jr. Clarence Nixon is out there. So everybody is out there who's tuning in, commenting. Thank you guys so much. So Lowell Litchmore says over here, is it Friday already?
It is.
The gang's all here. Welcome, Lowell. Look, time is moving, man. Just another few Fridays, and we're going to be talking about what the first round looks like. Feel me? So let's let it move. I'm ready.
Yeah, exactly.
Can't wait, baby. Let's do it. Draft day's coming. That's where Joe makes his money. He's a draft guy. If his second free agency was good, first draft was killer, he's going to knock this thing out of the park.
And there's an enormous amount of talent in positions of need for us this season also. So, I'm saying.
So, all right, DJ, talk to me. What were your thoughts on the Jets and free agency?
Man, I love the Corey Davis pickup. Fun fact, I had a few best friends that played with him at Western Michigan, and I had some best friends that played against him at NIU. Corey Davis. So I've had my own Corey Davis for a while now, but you know, I them picking that. Him up, huh?
Yeah, actually, Jimmy called that deal.
Yeah, I knew he was gonna do that.
So, and I have the audio clip. Yeah, I just haven't loaded it to the soundboard, but I do have it.
No, we're not going to talk about Carl Lawson. He's just going to be a beast regardless anyways.
Carl Lawson, you remember what I was telling you guys, all those stats with Carl Lawson, man. That's like the best signing we have so far.
And look, I kept saying, look, if Carl Lawson is going to be the guy. We bring him in. I'm telling you right now, that alleviates all this.
I knew Kevin was going to do that. Anyway,
you remember those numbers, man. I read those numbers off. You want to run through a wall.
Right, let's move on.
With the Corey Davis pickup, you know, he'd have went for 1,000 yards had he not caught COVID.
Okay, exactly.
And he had two games where he went score and he went catchless. I don't even know. I mean, I watched him in the film, but you know, that was sloopy stuff. But yeah, like he's gonna be able to be, if not a bona fide number one, but a very, very good number one wide receiver for the Jets. Like he excels in play action, which the Jets are going to run a lot of because that's what they ran in San Francisco. They ran a lot of play action. They're 12th in the league. Well, the percentage varies. Some people say 12. I heard the other day it was 6. But they're 12, between 12 to 6 in terms of percentage of play action in the league. So they're going to run a lot of that. Corey Davis was 4th in the NFL in play action yards behind the likes of Tyreek Hill, Calvin Ridley, Stephon Diggs. That's great company to be in with. You know what I'm saying? And he was in a run-heavy, dominant offense where they were running the ball more times than they were passing it. And he had A.J. Brown on the other side. So with him being able to be the number one, having been in the league for a while now, he's still young, that's a really good pickup. And you're paying less for him than the Patriots paid for Nelson Aguilar. So, you know.
Yeah.
It's a good way to look at it.
Right, exactly. Love the Carl Lawson pickup. Because even though he only has 5.5, 6 sacks, he gets to the quarterback.
Yes, he does.
He gets a lot of pressures. And we all saw that last Super Bowl, what pressures can do to a quarterback, you know? So no matter how good they are. So, yeah, I really like that pickup because, you know, we're at the point where the Jets need to just continue to bring in talent and, you know, build the roster from the ground up. So we'll see what they do in the draft. But, you know, them getting on him, those two, then getting, you know, LaMarcus Joyner for a really low, you know, a cheap deal. Let's see if you can get him back to that 2017, 2018 form. You get in Sheldon Rankins. If you can get him back to that 2018 form. Now, you know, you've just inserted guys that can really step in and improve the defense tremendously, you know. So, yeah, man, I really like those pickups. And, you know, we'll see what happens in the draft.
Really excited about those in particular. Mm-hmm.
So, speaking of which, what areas of the team do you think the Jets have improved from last year, and which areas do you think they still need to improve?
So, they improved at wide receiver with, you know, Keenan Cole also, who was a very good player in Jacksonville, very good. They got Tevin Coleman. They can still improve on running back, but being able to, you know, bring him in, that would add depth because we all know running backs get hurt. So, you got to have depth at that position. They improved the D-line, of course. That D-line with Sheldon Rankins.
It's going to be nasty. William,
Paul Lawson.
Yeah, man.
It's going to be nasty.
You got veteran Vin Curry in there. He's going to motivate Bryce Hoff. Man, that's some exciting stuff.
Exactly. Because we all know if you have a good defensive line, that makes everybody else's job easier.
Yeah.
So, yeah, you know, they were able to, you know, keep Marcus May. They franchise tag. I'm not really big on those, but he's still here. You got Joyner. We'll see how that works out. So those are, you know, that's where they improved on. What we still need to improve on, we all know it's cornerback. And
got it. You nailed it. Right.
At least you got the state of the team down. Right. How could we miss that stuff? Right? the two most glaring. And I mean, again, notwithstanding what it is that we do at number two, and I'm sure we'll talk about that again going forward. I did just kind of want to ask just a little bit more of a clarifying between those two, which one do you think we should address earlier based on, you know, kind of who you see on the board right now, or who do you expect to be available?
Man, so
you say my man, I'm going to get so happy.
Say who?
I wasn't saying, I was seeing you inside.
Like I go back and forth. So it's like one day it's cornerback. The other day it's, offensive line. But me, like, it just, I really, really like Greg Newsom from North.
I knew it.
I love him, bro. But, man, I like Tevin Jenkins from Oklahoma State. And it's like, you know, obviously, you know, you can we'll see who's available. Cause you know, I like you. You can also get the DN that didn't play that last year out of Miami. Gregory, I forgot to pronounce his last name. Don't want to butcher it. Good get him. There's a lot of options that the Jets could go at 23. There's still going to be a lot of talent there. You know what I'm saying? Or you could, you know, I wrote that you can go get Zaven, I think Collins from Tulsa. So, a linebacker, but that's not as big of a need. But I think if I had to choose, I think I'd probably go corner because, man, that corner unit last year. I do think Bryce Hall could take another step forward, but because I think you can go corner, you can go corner, and then you can get the offensive tackle out of Notre Dame. You can get because he might still be there in the second round.
Yeah, second round, yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So it just all depends. You know, you're gonna have an early second round pick. So
I'm saying you speak in my language right now. You know, as a cornerback in particular, I always say that the cornerback for me is going to take precedence, especially considering what it is that we've done with the defensive line. Yes. And because of really how much of a stud I think Bryce is going to end up being. So right. Greg Newsom and Bryce, man, you'll never hear me discuss cornerback again, at least until, you know, it'll be years before you even have me mention it. I don't think we have to talk about it other than which one of these guys is going to end up going to the Pro Bowl. So I'm really looking forward to that. Great answer. Thank you for that.
No problem.
I think the Jets can safely go corner later in the draft.
Yeah, there's some guys.
Let me just put this out there because I'm doing a video on the kid tomorrow for my channel. But Kerry Vincent Jr. out of LSU, fastest player in the draft. He just did his pro day at a 4.33 40, but he's also clocked at a 4.24 40. So
Eric Stokes is just as fast.
I have a film breakdown coming on Kerry Vincent Jr. tomorrow, and let me tell you, man, he opted out of 2020, so you could probably get him in the fourth, fifth round. And I think he's gonna be he was pushed into the slot, into the nickel corner role, because they have Derek Stingley Jr. At LSU. So Vincent can play on the outside. He's got the speed and he's got the ability to do it, but I think that my first three picks, quarterback, center, guard,
two. You speak my language, Jimmy.
34.
Speaking. I don't know how I feel. You know, I'm a big trenches guy, and that's, you know.
Yeah, I play corner two, Kevin.
I think Joe, I, you know, yeah.
I know you play corner two. I'm just saying, to me, and this is, you know, just how I'm looking at it, there might be 10 corners in the top 100, right? But then you figure if you're talking about waiting until the fourth and fifth round, you're not going to get one of those upper echelon guys. You're going to get another project or something like that.
I don't know. Sure. I'm not sure about that. In the third round, I think. Do you think Eric Stokes could be there with the 66th overall? Because he could be a legit starter.
If the top three are gone, if Caleb Farley, Surtain, and J.C. Horn, if those guys are gone.
I'm hoping Horn can fall.
Look,
I would love it.
Yeah, please. If Horn's at 23, I legitimately would consider it.
That's what I'm talking about.
I'm going on.
Horn's my guy. I've been big on Horn a long time.
Here's the way it breaks down for me. At 23, if by some miracle Quiddy Pay is there, you take that edge rusher at 23.
Yeah, no, there's no choice.
If Quiddy Pay is gone, but J.C. Horn is there, you take J.C. Horn. I totally agree. If those two are gone, my pick is Creed Humphrey at center. Humphrey at center at 23. I'm not Wyatt Davis at guard at 34. That is a top 10 New York Jets offensive line in 2020.
You know, that's been my draft a long time. Like, that's my first pick.
We did it together, man.
We were vibing on that stuff. I'm a big trenches guy. I know Joe is too. And he showed it, you know, in free agency, he built the defensive side of the trenches. I just feel like he's going to address interior high. 100%. You need that awesome center, that guy that shows the cerebral aspects that we talked about, you know, on your podcast, Jimmy. It's Creed all day. I feel like, again, you take Wyatt after that. I would take corners after that. I mean, Stokes could still be on the board. Elijah Molden could still be on the board.
Kerry Vincent Jr. Like,
but I got to go interior offensive line. Like, I got to get Creed. I need that next Nick Mangold. That, you know, Becton and Humphrey are going to be the next to Brick and Mangold for the next decade.
I said it.
Yeah, Creed. Yeah, man. Creed is special. Okay. Creed is. I've been on that guy for like over a year.
Best center prospect in the last decade. Real talk. Not even a question. And it's not close.
I'm out of
that. Decade be 2010. You can definitely make that argument. Yeah.
I'll just put it this way. If JC Horn is there at 23, I'm going to pull a hamstring trying to run the car down. I'll tell you right now.
For me, the only way I'm passing on Creed is for Horn or Jeremiah Owusu-Koromoa. That's it. Other than that, it's Creed all day.
Like that guy, I like that kid too, man. I don't know, man. Exactly. Look, again, a lot of talent available for us, man, regardless of really what it is that we do. I really think there can be arguments to be made for, you know, us, you know, just kind of playing it back and still picking up a guy, you know, maybe later on that has the level of talent. I think that'll still be an improvement over what we had. So that's what's good right now. I'm really excited, man. It's a great time to be a Jets fan. Seriously.
Yeah, absolutely. All right. So I got another question here. What are your thoughts on GM Joe Douglas and his approach to free agency in the draft? JD seems to be implementing a little bit of the Ravens model under Ozzie Newsome here, in my opinion. What say you? Do you think it can be successful here within the New York Jets organization?
Yeah, most definitely, because as we've already just spoke on, he's building up the trenches. When you build up the D-line to where it is now, that's only going to make, again, everybody's job easier on defense. Linebackers, corners, safeties, make their job easier. Then, you know, once you build up the O-line, which we all, you know, alluded to, that's going to make whether it's Zach or Justin Fields' life a lot easier to throw the ball. So it's going to give Corey Davis more time to get open. It's going to give Denzel Mims more time to get open. It's going to, whoever the running back is, it's going to give them easier lanes to run through. So yeah, building up any GM that believes in building up the trenches can be my GM too. So
facts, though.
I'm with you, bro.
Yeah, all right. And we got
every single good team. We've yet to see a bad team with a bad O line,
right? It's impossible.
Kansas City, like, the only reason why they lost their Super Bowl is because their O line became decimated, but they still had a really, really good D line. You had Chris Jones, you had Frank Clark, you know what I'm saying? Then you had with Tampa Bay, they had a stud D and offensive line, like straight Pro Bowlers, all pro on both sides. You know what I'm saying? Like, doesn't, if you have both taken care of, O line and D line, you're going to be great. You're going to be set. It's going to make everything easier. That's why the Ravens are always good. Because their deep and offensive line are all good. Since I've been alive.
Yeah, I feel like literally.
It's always been like that.
Yeah, for real. Yeah. And Ozzie Newsome is going to get a ton of credit for realizing where it is that he needs to plug in holes. Joe Douglas is from that tree, has that pedigree. I kind of allude to just something that you said earlier about how Kansas City kind of got exposed, you know, in the championship game because of the injuries that they had. Joe Douglas right now, I think that might be why I'm not as pressed about him slow playing it the way that he is, because to me, I'm actually looking at it as a quality versus quantity type situation when it comes to that.
Absolutely.
But the defensive line, the thing that really impresses me the most is that he's got a quantity of quality guys that he's brought in. You know what I'm saying? Like every single one of them guys, man. It's like if we can get them at, you know, 80-90% of what it is that we've seen them do, our defense is just, it's going to be so absolutely nasty. I'm starting to get sick already because of how crazy, how bad this is going to be, I think. And again, I'm the guy that says until we actually figure it out on offense, our defense is going to be the linchpin. It's going to be what needs to hold us. And I think it just seems like what it is that he's doing is putting us in position to have that situation be how it plays out. Our defense stacked. It's going to be really good up front. We have some question marks on the back end. But then again, like you said, you brought in May. We brought in Landon. I'm going to draw a blank on the guy's name. Excuse me. But yeah, exactly. But Joyner, excuse me. But then we still got Austin Davis, and let's not sleep on that guy because the kid's an athlete.
Yeah,
Ashton. I'm gonna tell you, because I grew up in Cali, and a lot of my guys out there, they were telling me we got a stud. The kid actually, you know, just looking at the coaching staff last season, I'm not sure if he actually got fed the way that he needed to get fed. But coming into this new defense and understanding what Sala did with less in San Francisco, I got a really bad feeling, man. Jets fans are going to be coming out of the woodwork this season with defensive jerseys on deck. You might want to get them now because, you know, the All Fans Willow web pages where you can buy jerseys are going to be out by midseason if it works out the way that I'm expecting it to work. So, yeah, man.
Guys, I got some breaking news.
What?
Did we trade
breaking Miami? News.
Oh, yeah.
All right. So, this is courtesy of Rockaway Archie. I want to thank him for dropping this in the chats. Article from the New York Post. Deshaun Watson, now the center of a criminal investigation.
Wow.
This is breaking. The situation is fluid. NewYorkPost.com actually has it. The title of it is Texans Deshaun Watson, Subject of Criminal Report in Houston. So again, breaking news right here on Weapons Hot. So, anyhow.
Man, I thought you were going to mention like a signing, and I was like, here. I was ready. Then you said that, Sam? And I was like, oh, that was massive.
Did we trade Sam? Did we trade Sam?
Right, right, exactly.
When so, you said breaking news, I was like, please don't let it be something I have to go write about right this
week. Right. TJ's like, I'm out. Peace. I got to go.
Right.
Oh, nah.
So.
Yeah, don't worry about it. You can hold off on this one.
Right, exactly.
But to piggyback off of what you were saying, though, that's why I think the Jets could possibly like do a lot better than people expect. Like, I think they could finish ahead of the Patriots this year, in my honest opinion.
I'm just not that high
on the Patriots. And like two, Patriots, once you get that fourth place schedule, it allows you to be able to make, you know, big jumps in the NFC. That's how the Dolphins were able to capitalize off that. You get three last place teams, you have to play them. That gives you like a couple extra wins. I feel like the Jets are gonna be able to get some of that next year. If the defense can play up to its potential, I think, yeah, like the Jets will be able to steal some wins and even potentially have a better record than the Patriots this year. I don't really see the Jets finishing dead last this year. Based on who they draft that quarterback, though, because let's say – I mean, I don't think this is going to happen. But let's say they go out there and they draft Mac Jones. Then, you know, all better.
Come on, man.
Don't do that to me.
Plus, but let me just throw this in and then I'll shut up because I've been talking about all night. But historically – first-year head coaches do extremely well here, right? We can go look that up. There are stats to back that up. So, you see me? Well, Adam, maybe not necessarily.
Well, I mean, he won seven games.
Yeah, he did.
Sam Darnold was out for like three of them.
Yeah. So historically,
Top Bowls' best year was his first. Yeah. No, that
historically, legit. Jets coaches do well their first year, and I'm just going to be honest with you because we have a little bit of a different pedigree in our head coaching situation in this case. Do I expect it to be his best year? Because really, unfortunately, those guys, their best year was their first, and then they kind of fell off after the fact. I think this guy's going to have a great first year and then be able to build upon that exponentially and grow. So, look, my expectation, if we don't win 9 or 10 games this season, I would actually be disappointed.
What?
I'm serious.
9 or 10 games?
I'm serious. I'm serious.
I like the expectation. I hope it's true.
I'm serious. Look, I'm telling you right now. I know it's going to be hard, but this is the reason why I say what I say, okay? Because, again, when you're talking about not having film, when you're not talking about not necessarily knowing what it actually is going to look like, you know, you're going to have some games where teams just really don't know how to handle what it is that you're doing. You know what I'm saying? And I mean, if we have two or three of them games, if we have two or three of them games this season, I'll tell you as well.
If DJ's tripping over Kevin's 9 game wins,
he's gonna.
You're about to walk out of your Miami Dolphins stadium right now, my friend, because I looked at our schedule and I see the Jets going 11-6.
See, I didn't want to go that far, but I'm
he saying, says oof.
I didn't want to go that far, but I'm kind of right behind you. I'm like, yo, we're gonna win some of these games that people don't think we're gonna.
I'm not even kidding. Hold on.
With you? Let's run through the schedule real quick. And I wanted to ask Daniel about this too because obviously we're not the only team that's improving. Other teams are improving, but other teams are also losing players. You know what I'm saying? So, I mean, we're gonna look at what we expect and then see a team that isn't going to be what it is that they were, right?
Let's run down this real quick, okay? At Atlanta,
we'll win that game.
Do we really think that we're going to lose against that Atlanta defense?
I mean, to be fair, you got to keep in mind the NFL draft hasn't happened yet. A lot of moving pieces could still happen.
Just, you know, things
aren't set yet. So I feel like it's hard to get a gauge per se. Like
I'm
would wait till.
That game.
I'd wait till training camp. Like I would see. Got to wait till training
camp.
Head down.
I'm going to be at that game. First round's on me. Come on.
I think dates are still to be determined, so I'm just going down the line from footballschedules.com, right? So Atlanta, that's chalk it up as a dub. At Buffalo, that's probably going to be tough. I'm going to call that one an L.
Yeah. Probably.
Probably.
Hey, look,
I'm a Jet guy. I want to win them all. We play Buffalo 16-0 next year. 16-0.
We play Buffalo tough though.
Wow. Talk about overreactions. Wait a second. I got to throw a flag on this because this is just getting crazy right here. All right. Before we start with the over the top reactions for schedule or whatever, can we get through the draft first?
I'm with you, CJ. I'm saying the same thing, man. No. I'm with you.
Oh my God! All right, Kevin.
Jimmy's ready.
If we just base it off of this right now.
I am famous for doing my way too early predictions, and I'm telling you guys before I was even a co-host on this show, when I was on as a fan guest. Remember this, CJ?
Remember this, Browns.
Kevin,
because I did this. What I said on the very first show is that not only is Jamal Adams replaceable, he is easily replaceable. Yep. That was a year before it happened.
Yep, I get that.
Well, to be fair, the safety position is not what it used to be. I mean, it's just like having an all-star running back. Like, Ezekiel Elliott's amazing. You can replace that nowadays.
Listen, I predicted 10-6 last year, and you know what? I got 2-14. So you know what? We didn't get our first win until, like, it was 0-13. And at that point, we were all, like, in full tank mode. We were just like, just lose every game. You know, Trevor Lawrence is going to be in New York Jet, and then come the Rams.
And that all went down the toilet, DJ.
All I'm saying is that when I put out a take that everybody's like, way too early to say that. You can't say that yet. Don't say that yet. Yeah. My track record is Chris Sims, okay?
I'm saying.
So, all right.
It is what it is, boys. It is what it is.
All right.
Yeah, but DJ, based on what you were saying before, I had a quick question for you. Because you know, everyone's talking, you know, Zach Fields, Justin Wilson. Justin Fields.
What is this, a hybrid entering the draft we don't know about there, Harrison?
When I do, you know, my QB eval, my QB big boards, you know, Zach Wilson is, to me, by far, way in a well, the second guy. But I've always said that, you know, Trey Lance checks all the boxes that I look for as well. But with D2, it's just tough for me. And, you know, I had him, in my opinion, better than Fields. So, like, what do you feel about the fact that, you know, it's all Zach Wilson, Justin Fields? I did it again.
I don't know about Trey Lance. What do you think about the no Trey Lance in that conversation?
Because Trey Lance didn't play last year. So, like, if he would have just stepped into – if you were to draft Trey Lance with the Jets, like, you would have to keep Sam Darnold. You have to bring somebody else in and, like, let them
play. Totally.
For sure. Because, like, if you throw Trey Lance into the Jets situation right now.
No, you kill him.
Yeah, exactly. Like,
that 17 games at the FCS level is not pro-ready.
No, he's not.
Don't get me wrong. I'm Zach Wilson all day. I just don't get why people that want, you know, Justin Fields aren't talking about Trey Lance.
Well, because, I mean, Justin Fields is better than Trey Lance.
Most definitely. But open up
that Pandora box. He's better than Trey.
Trey Lance
has more upside than Mac Jones, though.
I'm not
drafting Mac Jones when Trey Lance.
Name an Ohio State quarterback that is translated to the NFL properly.
I don't care about none of that.
Maybe USC.
I don't care about
right. Name. Exactly.
But you can't do that though because then name the Clemson quarterback that translated to the NFL before Deshaun Watson.
Right, none.
Well, yeah, but it's been Deshaun Watson now. Deshaun Watson squashed that
before Patrick Mahomes.
Okay, so this is what I'm saying, that Fields could be that this is what squashes.
All it takes is one.
We're talking about a similar skill set here. Okay, which again, I think people are overlooking. Again, we're talking about a similar skill set in a similar guy who's going to be moving into, I think, what would be a much better situation. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Come on now. Let's not sleep on that. And again, I'll say this. Well, look, if we're going to keep it real, the draft begins at 3, right? In San Francisco?
No. The draft begins at 7.
Yeah, 7 o'clock. Dude, we're going to be live at 6:30. Some of us are going to be already trashed by the time we take the air, so don't worry.
We got questions about what's going to go on at 3, though.
No, I don't.
I do. Because you're saying that they want to draft Mac Jones. And
yeah,
I'm like,
if
the 49ers draft Mac Jones, that's a wasted pick. Kyle Shanahan's a great coach. I'll give it.
I'm telling you guys, do not be shocked at all. Don't be shocked that they take Trey Lance. I'm telling you, don't be shocked.
I said they were going to draft Trey Lance because they're keeping Jimmy Garoppolo.
Wait a second. Let DJ chime in. DJ. Talk to me. I know you want to say something because I see you. You're like, you're squirming around in that seat like you want to get a word in. Go for it, bro. Come on.
Probably because we said Mac Jones so many times. It's making him uncomfortable.
Yeah, I mean, like, they trade up. They gave up all that for somebody that's going to be there at 12.
Yeah, Mac Jones.
Good
luck to them. Period. Hey.
Anytime somebody says, oh, well, Mac Jones likely will be there at 12, or he'll likely do this, or he'll likely be at this position. There's a lot of likelies in those types of statements. Now, what happened when Gettleman took Danny Dimes at 6? Everybody was like, you're crazy.
And has
Gettleman,
it will. Ish, don't worry, that will.
Ish.
I got faith in that, man. I like
my point,
quarterback, man.
He had 11 touchdowns, 14 interceptions last year.
I'm not saying I'm a Danny Dimes fan. I'm just saying that from a general manager perspective, mm-hmm. when you're expecting a QB run in the top half of the first round of the draft, yeah. you're gonna go to get your guy.
Okay, that makes sense. I see what you're saying.
Yeah,
and that's my whole point, right? Now, whether you or me or CJ or Kevin or Harrison or anybody out there, whether we feel that Mac Jones warrants that type of a trade up. Mm-hmm. The fact of the matter is if the San Francisco 49ers feel that that is their guy and they sense a quarterback run coming, which I think they offered the Jets a pick at 2 because I think they wanted Wilson, yeah. and I think they were ready for a Jones or, you know, whoever the case may be. But I'm thinking the offer – one of two things happened, okay? Either the offer was made and rejected, or the offer was not made because they knew number 2 wasn't for sale.
Hey, bro, that's what I said. You remember my take? That's literally what I said.
We talked about this on the show. They were standing right next to each other when the trade was announced.
Right.
Right? Lynch and JD, they were standing right next to each other.
So the fact of the matter is, I see San Francisco trying to move off of Garoppolo. I can probably see Garoppolo going Carolina maybe. But I really think that San Francisco.
Oh, man, I can see Bill bringing him home. I can just see it.
Not with them just signing Cam again for a year.
I don't know.
It's just 1 year, though. It's just 1 year. 1 year.
I don't know.
I mean, I don't think it's the right move, but I definitely can see that happening.
I actually see Trey Lance.
In New England before I see Garoppolo.
I see Trey Lance falling to 15 to New England, but that's neither here nor there. My point on the whole matter is.
Wait.
I think DJ. That's irrational. That's crazy for me. I'm sorry.
I don't think any of these quarterbacks make it out the top 10. I think they all.
That's where I'm at.
And that's very possible. That's so there's a potential for a New England trade up to get somebody.
Yep.
But Justin Fields is going to be a Falcon, man.
I'm just saying, I don't think anybody's going to make it past Atlanta right there. I think they're probably going to be gone before we get there.
Carolina.
There won't be another one available.
I honestly have Trevor Lawrence, Zach Wilson is a QB1, QB1A, QB1B.
Yeah.
Huh? Yes. Zach Wilson.
1B with Zach Wilson.
And Zach Wilson is 1B.
Hey, bro, there's a couple of things that Wilson actually does better. There's a couple of things.
I get that, but like the other thing that Trevor Lawrence does is, you know, that does better, you know, he just does better, you know what I'm saying? Like,
I think
there's no way Jacksonville doesn't take him. Trevor Lawrence, Shaq Khan, like, pulls out like a 1800s pistol and shoots him right in the chest, the GM, right on the podium in that moment. Like, that ain't happening. And he's got the mustache, you know, he'll do it. He's got something on him, he's packing on that draft floor. He doesn't take Lawrence.
I'm just saying that this is the first time in NFL history that we're going to see the top 4 teams take 4 quarterbacks. It's going to be a 1-2-3-4 quarterback.
Wait a minute. Atlanta's a wild card to me. I think 1-3 would be, but Atlanta,
well,
I don't know.
I have it being Trevor Lawrence to the Jags, Zach Wilson to the Jets, Mac Jones to the Niners, or Justin Fields to the Atlanta Falcons. And I think that Cincinnati takes Penei Sewell, so he's the first non-quarterback to go at number 5. And Miami, you guys are getting Kyle Pitts at number 6.
Man, please do that.
Man, that'd be nasty. You give Tua Pitts. That means Tua can't succeed with Pitts, then he ain't in LA for him.
Right. I mean, I'm like, Pitts for Chase. I'm like, man.
Chase, though.
I mean, you do need a legit wide receiver once. So Chase, Jamar Chase definitely fits the bill.
Chase, though.
It could be, but I mean, you got to think that Kyle Pitts is going to go somewhere.
You know what?
And Kyle Pitts is not just a tight end. We all know that. Kyle mm-hmm. Pitts is yeah, he can line like, up wherever.
Dude, that's my boy right there. I love Kyle Pitts.
Wide receiver one, that guy.
Fair enough. Put him at wide receiver one. You have a 250-pound wide receiver one that runs a 4.440, yeah, man. I'm okay with it. Yep. I'm just like, saying the guy's yeah. going number six to Miami. Okay.
Give me a 5'10 corner that's gonna match up with that kid.
I know. I'm just saying that the first four teams need quarterbacks.
To be fair, Asante Samuel Jr. held his own pretty well against Pitts in a couple of games. You know he really what? Did. He really did.
See, Asante Samuel Jr. is another reason why we keep talking about the cornerback.
Bell will be able to handle Pitts. It's the linebackers
I can't.
That won't.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Yep. Wow. Lowell Litchmore in the comments just said Pitts to the Giants.
Hits the Giants.
Yeah,
no way.
Another thing, too, I love Lowell. He's awesome. Let me tell you. He's like, Chris Sims has Mac Jones ahead of Fields.
Yeah, he does. Right. There's quite a few people that do at this point.
Yeah.
I have Lance ahead of Fields.
No, I'm just look. I don't understand the field slander right now. I'm just going to keep it real.
Hey, bro, I told you, I got into it a lot on my podcast. I hate to say it, but. In a short, condensed way, 100% situational system quarterback. 100% system quarterback.
He is very, very slow on his reads. Justin Fields.
No, the reads are built in. They're built into his system.
I don't. Which is great. I can't agree with that.
One or two.
I cannot agree with that.
Never gets beyond it.
Yeah, but that doesn't mean that he can't.
No. It doesn't mean that he can't. It doesn't mean he can't. But he's got to learn it. Yeah, exactly. It doesn't mean he can. He's got to learn it. Lance has it, and Wilson has it in spades.
Are we not saying this about Justin Herbert last year? And then what?
Dude, I had Herbert as my number one. I thought Herbert was the best kid in that draft. Nah. I did. I loved Herbert.
Herbert.
I'm sorry. Lowell Litchmore chimes in and goes, Justin Fields will be the next Jeff Blake. I'm sorry.
What did he say?
Said, Justin Fields will be the next Jeff Blake.
You know what?
Wow.
That's funny. Oh my God. Oh. Somewhere losing his mind right now.
Dude.
You cut off at the bar, Lo. You cut off at the bar. That was the last one for you tonight. That was the last one.
And that's such an interesting reference, too. I like it.
Wow.
That was a horrible take. I'm even angry that it came down that way. People may not like Justin Fields. I've seen film of Justin Fields go through four reads.
That's what I'm saying.
And I've seen it. I've seen it happen. So I mean,
people point it out because there's few and far between.
It doesn't make a difference. It's done. It's on film. It's there. It's available to be seen. And it was effective. And he scored on that.
But his pocket presence
plays
too.
Out of his thousand Look, plays.
It's a lot. It's a lot. We can talk about this for a long time.
I don't care.
When
it
comes to
QB, he showed the ability. You put him in a situation and allow him to have the opportunity to do it. I'm telling you right now.
Oh, there's Lino. There's Lino in the chat. Nothing but haters on the best quarterback in the draft. GTFO, would Justin Fields be the best quarterback in the draft?
Wow.
What did you say, DJ?
In a Kyle Shanahan West Coast offense that the Niners, that the Jets are going to run, a lot of the reads are going to be predetermined anyway.
Anyway. See?
Yep.
Anyway, you're going to have to do like one or two reads anyways. It's not, they're going to skip. Like the Niners, one thing that, their offense, why it's so deadly is because a lot of the times they've already won before the snap.
Yeah,
so
RPO.
In that position. He's going to cook just as you don't cook because his ceiling is higher than Zach Wilson. I don't care what nobody talking about. His ceiling is higher than Zach Wilson.
Look.
So you put him in that situation, he's going to cook and he's going to do his thing too. Just saying.
Look, I have reasons for wanting the Jets to draft Justin Fields that really kind of have nothing to do with football. It's more of a fan base thing for me.
I mean, I would disagree, but I think we'll be here until 10 o'clock at night.
Yeah, look, you can disagree as much as you
want. We ain't got time for that.
Like I said,
save it for after dark.
It has nothing at all to do with football. It has to do with a fan base issue. I'm going to stop right there.
Okay. A tease for the next after dark.
Yeah, because it had to be after dark. I mean, FCC regulator right here. We get ready to go in.
Right. All right. So, ladies and gentlemen, it's time for Mr. Kevin Jackson's solo segment.
We're going to do it.
And we're going to find out who he's got in tonight's White Hot Spotlight.
In the Spotlight. With Kevin Jackson. Kevin Jackson.
Top Spotlight. Jax, who are we talking about tonight?
ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, it's spirited conversation tonight, yeah? I actually would like to give a spotlight to all of my panel mates this evening because we have been kicking a whole lot of ass. It's been a great show. Thank you guys for doing what it is that you do. DJ, thank you for bringing the heat with us tonight. Appreciate you. Thank you for all of the guests and the fans and all of that. I'm going to wrap this up real quick because I want to get back to the roundtable portion of our discussion this evening. In the spotlight tonight, Sam Darnold for the last time.
No, God.
for the last time. Not just here.
Should we play taps?
No. Well, I mean, possibly. But the reasoning behind why it is that I even put Sam in the spotlight this evening is because we have all of these questions at what it is that we're going to do at a quarterback. And we kind of alluded to a few different things and why it looks like our team is going to do one thing while all these other teams are going to do other things when it comes to that, the most important position in professional sports, right? Sam Darnold, who just a few years ago was looking like he was going to be, you know, like a Justin Lawrence, Trevor Lawrence type caliber kind of quarterback. We expected him to come in and be good. A lot of people had him ranked at the top of that class. I didn't. Just to be clear, I didn't. I still to this very day think Lamar Jackson was the choice. But I also think that the Jets would have ruined him. I think the Jets would have ruined him. And I mean, again, we're talking about the Jets, a team I love and a team I hate all in the same. But Sam Darnold at this point in time leaves so many questions because not only does it matter if somebody within the organization thinks that Sam Darnold might actually be able to be salvageable, but it also allows us to maybe enjoy some more flexibility around that 23 to 34 range. Because if we do draft him, the type of compensation that we get is going to be enough for us to make moves quite possibly back up until the end of the first or Benny again back into the beginning of the second round. And there is where we find the sweet spot as far as talent and adding talent to this team at positions that maybe some folks think that, you know, maybe we might not be able to do. Joe Douglas has fashioned himself as a master of the draft. Last season, for everybody's question marks and who's saying that, you know, he didn't draft certain guys that they didn't like, or, you know, or maybe he did some things, especially with the Denzel Mims trade. And I think, Harrison, you and I, we talked about this one how many times, because I thought it was a genius move, and then still getting a first round talent after trading back. And then, you know, still look, Joe Douglas right now has a chip in his pocket that I think maybe some folks are sleeping on. It's like if you're playing spades, and if you play spades, it's almost like having a little joker, right? Because the little joker is going to beat almost everything except the one, the big joker. You can hold on to that little joker. And really, when people least suspect it, you slap that thing down and you clear the board and you might set somebody else. So just a spades analogy right there. But he's holding on to the little joker right now, which is a lot more powerful at this point than I think most people are giving it credit for. Now, Sam Darnold is not going to get a first round draft pick back in compensation. That's not going to happen. But we don't need him to. All we need him to do is to garner enough to be able to add a certifiable piece of draft capital that's going to allow Joe Douglas to maneuver back into positions where we're literally talking about maybe a top 10 or 15 talent at their position in this draft coming up. All right. So Sam Darnold's in the spotlight, but it's not really about Sam Darnold. It's about what it is that we're going to be able to recoup for Sam Darnold. Joe Douglas has shown an affinity for being able to get much more in return than what it is that we would have ever expected him to get from anyone. Sam Darnold in the spotlight tonight, guys. But again, what do we get back for Sam when we trade him? Because he's got to go. We can't keep him. There's no way.
You are a factory of sadness!
Right?
This is what I hear. What do you guys whenever I hear Sam Darnold's name mentioned, and what are we going to get back, and this, that, and the third.
So much like Adam Gase.
Right. Well, that too.
I won't say his name.
We've already said it like six times. I've counted it. It stings every time it touches my face.
Right. It's yeah. We should turn it into a drinking game. So right? Like we did with Doug Marrone. So, but, you know, look, as far as Sam Darnold is concerned, and I had this conversation with Rockaway Archie earlier today, and I've had it with several other fans, you know, of Weapons Hot over past weeks. But Sam Darnold has got to go. He's not salvageable. But as long as there is an offensive coordinator in the NFL who thinks that they can fix this kid, the Jets are going to get something for him. Now, we may not get the first round pick that we all hoped and dreamed that we would get, okay? We may get a second-round pick. We may get a third-round pick, okay? They're not going to give up Sam Darnold for a seventh rounder, which is like the equivalent of a bag of balls and a slightly used jockstrap, okay? So Sam Darnold is going to garner something, and it's going to be the team that's probably going to panic because they're going to see all the quarterbacks go off the board.
That's what I said.
And they're going to sit there and in a panic move, they're going to say, okay, we'll give you a second for Sam. And that's where Joe Douglas is going to make his mark. So, Jax, I totally agree with you about the chip in his pocket. You know, we may not see Sam get dealt until draft day or maybe day two of the draft or possibly even day three of the draft. But you know what? He's going to be dealt because there's no way that you can go and draft another quarterback and still have Sam Darnold on this roster.
It's not a situation like you have Jimmy Garoppolo in San Francisco and you draft a guy that's going to end up playing down the road. That's not the kind of situation that we have here.
Yeah. So. No, I 100% agree with you guys. And I had like a bunch of takes on this. And I actually on my podcast on Monday, I actually was reading Kim Martin, you know, the big reporter. She actually broke a story back on Monday where she had spoken personally to three NFL GMs and they had told her that they valued Sam Darnold at around a third round pick range. Whoa. And then one of them even said that a third rounder was a little too rich. And I mean, we get upset about that. We say, oh, maybe he's worth a first or a second, but think about all the stuff we've been saying. We've been saying, you know, Sam is the worst statistical quarterback in the league. He's bad. He's this, he's that. Well, they see it too. They see the same things we see. So I think, like you said, draft day is going to be a big factor, you know, especially with 1, 2, 3. Without question, those are going to be QBs off the board. So teams are going to start asking themselves with, like, you know, later round picks. Now they're comparing Sam Darnold to Kyle Trask or Mac Jones, as opposed to, you know, before comparing him to Lawrence and Wilson. But I think what CJ said is important. I had said this as well. I don't think Sam could be on this team no matter what. Like, I don't care what we get for him at this point. When you take a quarterback with a second overall pick, you're making a statement. That's a high pick. You're investing that this guy is our new future. And Kev, you said it. I mean, this isn't an older guy dynamic. Our team, even our fan base right now, is completely split. We have a bunch of people that still think Sam could be the guy. Still think he could make it, regardless of the numbers, regardless of anything they see. You can't have that debate. You can't take a quarterback second overall and then have that debate. So I'm in the feeling of, you know what, even if we could only get a sixth for Sam Darnold, we have to bite our freaking tongues and do it because we can't have that debate. We just can't have, you know, fans saying, you know, can Zach be the guy? Maybe Sam can still be the guy. We got to be all in on whoever we take it to.
Man, that's a crazy take because the fact of the matter is that the longer we wait, the less compensation I actually think that we end up getting back. So a 6th round pick in return, as difficult as that might be. Jeez, please don't say that.
Yeah, I don't want it, but I just feel like no matter what, we just can't have him on the team because there's going to be that controversy. The fan base is going to be split. I feel like we got to make this guy the guy. If you're taking him at 2, again, that's a statement.
Got to do it. DJ, what do you think, man?
Sam got to go. I mean, it's pretty simple. Sam has to go. It is what it is. It didn't work out. It's only a matter of time until he's gone. I mean, I don't even think he'd want to be here, though. Like,
yeah, look, that even more.
Because there's no way he hasn't heard the rumblings or even unless he's been in a cave and been hiding for months. That's the only way he hasn't seen all the chatter or read maybe a clipping or something. There's no way he's under the impression of he's going to be the quarterback next year. If he is, then somebody, either he's delusional or somebody's doing a really good job of lying to him. So, whatever you can get at this point. I think Miami got a 4th round pick for Tannehill. But I mean, his value was I don't know if his value was way lower. But yeah, they got a 4th round pick for him.
Tannehill,
the Adam Gase factory drives down.
Yeah, but Tannehill actually had some decent, you know, play. You know, it's not like Tannehill was 32nd quarterback in the league.
D8. Like, it was like, all right, he's borderline good. Could he take the next step? Awesome. So we're trying to see if Darnold can be borderline average, but you know.
See, that to me is the issue. What do you think? Yeah. What do you think, Jim?
The fact of the matter is, I'm going to be real short and sweet because I want to hear what CJ has to say. Darnold has to go. The Darnold experiment has failed. The guy had good coaching at USC. He played 27 games, turned the ball over 37 times. That is not what I want in our quarterback. There is no reason that Jets fans can't expect more from the most important position in sports, period. End of story. Done. If it's a third, if it's a fourth, if it's a fifth, I don't care. Just give me the pick. Move on. I'm done.
There it is.
Yeah, TJ, I completely agree.
You're going to knock it out.
There's really nothing else that you could do at this point. I mean, you know, like I said before, if Sam Darnold's going to be dealt, he'll be dealt draft day or maybe day two, possibly day three. I actually listened to Fireball's video about that, especially with the Kimberly Martin section. Go to the Weapons Hot Facebook page and check it out as I shared the link. And you know what? I mean, I can understand where Kimberly was coming from, but, you know, look, Douglas upgraded the offensive line last year. Granted, it was not the upgrades that Jet fans wanted, but he brought better players than what we originally had in, all right? And, you know, it's not as if these players came from other places and just came to the New York Jets and magically sucked, okay? Because first off, Frank Pollock is a horrible offensive line coach. Should have fired his ass and hired Bill Callahan when he was let go by the Dallas Cowboys. That was mistake number one. Hey, all right, mistake number two was not going after more pieces besides McGovern and Van Rotten and bringing in Fant and so on. So, look, and we still need to know what Cameron Clark is. So, I mean, yeah. the Jets had the 29th overall offensive line in the NFL last year, which is actually a jump from when they were actually ranked 33rd out of 32 teams the year before. Okay? So, you know, I mean, look, the only place to go is up. So, at this point...
To be fair, we can stay exactly where we are.
If we have an offensive line that's like middle of the road, if we can get our offensive line to like 16th or 17th best in the league, that easily equals another 3-4 wins. But the problem is that the offense has been completely anemic. All right, it's been a joke, and you know Robert Saleh is coming in here with a complete clean slate. You know the defense is going to be running around with their hair on fire. But the thing that I want to see this upcoming season, and I'm sure DJ will agree with me and everybody else on this panel, is that the biggest problem with the New York Jets is the fact that the defense has had to spend an average of 65 to 70% of its time on the field. You cannot win ball games when your defense is exhausted in the fourth quarter and you need them to make a play because your offense can't pull its head out of its ass long enough to put a touchdown on the board. Okay? So, that being said, it also falls on the shoulders of Sam Darnold. Because regardless of who you have in the headset, whether it's Gase, whether it's Loggins, whether it's Cooter, whether it's Farmer Fran, whether it's, you know, Billy McGinty calling plays from the friggin' skybox, or Shane Falco calling plays in the headset from the parking lot, okay, from a walkie-talkie he hijacked, okay? Sam has to be able to figure it out. You can't miss wide-open receivers. You can't hold the ball for 7-8 seconds and then let yourself get blasted in a coverage sack because you can't get the ball out in time. So, and I'm sorry, but that falls at the feet of Sam. You can blame the Jets all you want. You can blame Adam Gase all you want. You can blame Todd Bowles. You can blame Mike McCagnan. You can blame whoever you want because everybody at this point is culpable. And yeah, it sucks. We pretty much maybe ruined this kid's career. But if he could go someplace else and hit the reset button and maybe be a competent backup, then maybe he could be in the league for the next 5-6 years, collect a paycheck, and do something with himself. Okay? But he's not going to do it here with the New York Jets organization. Why? Because we didn't do what we were supposed to do when we drafted the kid, which was build him an offensive line and get him weapons and get him a halfway decent coach in here instead, not some jackass who was up in the mountains for 5.5 years.
Isn't Chad Henne still in the league? Oh. Chad Henne, you remember that guy? He's still getting backup jobs.
Right.
Chad Henne.
I'm just saying.
Bring that man up.
I think Sam could be better than Chad Henne.
Well, yeah. You could haul a one Jets drive janitor out onto the field and he'd be better than Chad Henne.
I don't know. Ryan Fitzpatrick is still in the league too.
Dumb. All right. I'm just saying. But anyhow, that's my that's my rant on Sam Darnold, and you guys know how I feel. I've made it known for a while, so I just don't know what else to say. All right, so anyhow, it's time for tonight's final segment, which is called The Last Word, where everyone's going to give their final thoughts. So, DJ, you are the guest of honor tonight, my friend. So, please, kick it off for us.
Well, you know, I appreciate y'all having me on. This was a lot of fun. Fields is better than Mac Jones. Fields is better than he's right. You know, he's a this was a lot
DJ,
of
DJ, you got me on a Twitter follow back when San Francisco drafts Mac Jones?
I'm saying follow back now, man.
I'm about to follow back all y'all. I'm about to follow back all y'all. So that's,
I appreciate that.
But yeah, you know, this was a lot of fun. I really do enjoy doing podcasts because, you know, it's just people just, you know, I can't curse, but.
Yeah. You know, come on after dark, bro. Come on after
Yeah. Listen, if you come on after dark, then yeah, you can let the fur fly. It's all good.
After dark, you can say whatever you want to say.
Just whatever's on your mind. Just say it.
Yeah, that's it.
This was a lot of fun. You know, I really do respect all the podcasters that cover the Jets, because it's obvious that you all are passionate about this. Y'all put a lot of effort and work into this, and like this is y'all passion. And I love working with people and talking to people that are passionate about what they do, because I am too passionate about what I do. You can be passionate about driving trucks. I don't care. As long as you're passionate about it, you know, we can connect on that level. You know what I'm saying? Because hustlers, hard workers, you know, that always just brings everybody together at the end of the day. So I enjoy doing these podcasts with people.
This is good. Thank you, brother. Appreciate you.
That's a round of applause from Jets Nation for you, my friend. All right, so Fireball, fire it off.
Yeah, man. You know, we talked about so much, but I think the real thing, like we talked about, you know, is what's going on with Sam. I think it's like, you know, everything we've been saying, you know, that we were hoping he can get a higher pick, but, you know, we were saying that he sucked. And then there were reports saying that the NFL GMs agreed with that and he wasn't worth anything. Now people are saying he's worth a mid pick. I think that's what Joe's doing. Because, again, Joe's smart, guys. You know everything I've been saying about him. I love Joe Douglas, from his philosophies to the way he handles the draft, to the way he handled free agency. He's probably getting crab offers for Sam. He's getting maybe a fourth, a fifth, maybe lower. He's waiting until the draft. He's waiting because, again, like DJ pointed out, he'd be shocked if any of those top quarterbacks are there after the first round. So in the second round, teams might have to make a legit decision where it might be worth trading the 40th overall or the 45th overall or something to get Sam Darnold. So that's definitely what I think Joe's doing. I see Sam, you know, probably being dealt on draft day, but I just hope it happens. Like if we take Zach Wilson or whoever we take, I just hope Sam isn't there because we just can't have the controversy. That's my two cents.
All right, Jimmy, you're up.
So my final word, DJ, thank you so much for being here, man. I greatly appreciate it. And I actually found the tweet.
Jimmy's digging.
I've been scrolling through my Twitter. I'm like, what was it? So I tweeted out, it was March 14th. And I think you just talked about something from the Jets. And I was like, I was the jerk. So I was like, one of like two or three New York Jets tweets from you thus far, isn't it? You know, as the new Jets beat writer, we're heading into free agency. We'd think there'd be more than just Miami Heat retweets. I'm just saying, first impressions and all.
I remember that one. All right. I'm like on the clock yet.
All right. I told you, the expectation.
my guy quote retweeted that. So, hey, much love, dude. It was great talking to you, man. Real talk. And, you know, I'm an unreasonable Jets fan, just like most of us are unreasonable Jets fans. But, you know, you're coming into a situation where, like you mentioned earlier, the predecessor was a complete POS. And it's... it's not like you said that there were big shoes to fill. There's really not. It's just you have to change the dynamic of what the Jets fans consider that New York Daily News position to be, because the guy that came before you, he really screwed it up, man. So all the best to you, DJ, I hope you do well. I hope you enjoy it, and I hope the fan base isn't too hard on you, brother.
Just all take right. it in strides, bro. Take
right?
it in strides.
Look, all right, Jax, I know we're coming up against it. I'm going to go ahead and knock this out, okay? First and foremost, DJ, my guy, follow back, man, because we're going to have something to talk about. It's no question. Y'all all know that one of my sayings about the Jets in particular is that we suffer from another unfortunate side of hunger. Like, everybody has some sort of issue that they're dealing with, whether it be horrible takes, whether it be, you know, inability to trust with the draft process or what's going to happen with the team. At this point in time, I'm just going to be honest with you. I think Joe Douglas has like 3 Snickers bars, 2 Baby Ruths, and a couple of bags of Doritos in the trunk. He's getting ready to start feeding people right now, and we're going to eat, and we're going to be able to not necessarily have these types of ridiculous attitudes and takes going into next season. DJ, I'm glad that you're here, bro, because I think you're getting ready to see the transformation of what it looks like to go from a poorly run organization perennially to a team that actually has set itself up for success. And we're going to watch it in slow motion over the course of these next couple seasons. I'm telling y'all right now, Jets fans, once again, be ready, because what we're getting ready to see right now is a transformation. I know a lot of us have been a fan for 40 years, CJ, you know, how many hundreds of years worth of fandom we have assigned here, but
yeah, there's about 138 years of fandom on this panel right here, DJ.
What we're getting ready to see right now is something.
So a lot of PTSD, put it that way.
Yeah, a lot. Look, I used to have dreads.
Oh, you're bald now.
Yeah, no, feel me on that though. But this is where we're at. It's going to change, and we're actually watching the change of the guard happening right now. DJ, I'm glad you're aboard to witness it, and look forward to really interacting with you as we watch it unfold, right?
All right. So, as we wrap up tonight's episode of Weapons Hot, New York Jets fan broadcast, okay, we'll go around the room. DJ, please give out your social media information so fans of Weapons Hot can interact with you, follow you, if they don't already.
That would be DBIENAIMENYDN. Or you could just put DJ Bien-Aime. Should be able to find that. That won't be too hard. But yeah, that's my Twitter name. That's what I go by. If you know, check my Twitter, I'll probably be, you know, posting up memes, cracking jokes. Don't take my tweets.
Bunch of Miami Heat retweets.
Bunch of Miami Heat. But besides that though, you know. You know, I interact, you know, and DMs are open. So if you ever want to curse me out, go ahead, do your thing. You know what I'm saying? I'll just hit the delete button, but that's okay though. You know, you feel me?
Hey, at least you real talk.
Yeah, just they know that you saw it. That's the point.
Let's keep it real.
You know, but
that's it.
We saw it and deemed you not worthy. The app.
Yep, exactly. All right, so. Ladies and gentlemen, you can follow the show on Twitter at CNC Jets Factor. You can follow me at JetsFan0523. My partners in crime on the other side of the glass. We have Kevin Jackson at Spotty Blackman. Ladies, be sure you're writing that down, you little black books. Yeah. Jimmy the Reaper Jardine at Jets by Jimmy. And the Fireball at TF Jets Fan Media. Is that it?
It's NY Jets TF Media.
Okay.
There my we go. Company takes
I like can it. Never get that damn thing right. Can you shorten that thing for Christ's sake, please?
Now you got to start with NY Jets. That's how you do it, bro. Yeah. It's NY Jets and then the company. Yeah.
Yeah. All right. So, plenty of ways you could interact with the show. You could catch us on the Worldwide Sports Radio Network. Go to their website. Our content is up there. Download the app on Google Play for Android on Google Play. Go to the Play Store. You'll be able to get Worldwide Sports Radio Network app right there. For iPhone users, go to the iOS store, download it. You can catch Weapons Hot along with a plethora of other sports broadcast shows that are out there, like the Ryan Hickey Show, the Sports Hit List, the Wise Guys, which I think we're eating into their time tonight, but oh well.
Great content.
So be sure to go and check them out. Go to the Weapons Hot Facebook page. Also, go to our YouTube channel. We finally broke the triple-digit subscriber. So that means next week, Next week, Kevin Jackson promised us dancing girls.
Strippers.
So he got them.
FCC regulations.
So that's going to be funny for Weapons Hot After Dark next week. Also, keep in mind, Weapons Hot also is going to be broadcasting the draft. Yes, the draft, April 29th, starting at 6:30 p.m. It's going to be a YouTube exclusive video. Okay, so there's going to be a lot of cursing. There's going to be a lot of drinking. And we are going to televise all 32 picks.
Nice.
Not just the Jets picks, all 32 picks.
Make sure you got your beer.
Make sure you got your liquor. Make sure you got your sandwiches, your food. Put the kids to bed. Put the earplugs in. Go make yourself a bologna sandwich. And park your asses in front of your PC or your cell phone.
Right? I was just about to say, come on now. Can we get a turkey here?
Okay. Get the turkey. Get the Italian combo. Whatever you want. The roast beef and Swiss. Hey, drag it through the garden. Whatever floats your boat. Go get yourself the bucket of chicken wings. Okay? Hey.
Doesn't like bologna.
That's
bologna's
it.
Good stuff, man.
You do your thing. But Weapons Hot is going to be broadcasting the NFL draft live. We're going to give you live commentary. We are also going to have guys from the Ain't Easy Being Green podcast that are going to join us. So, along with a plethora of other guests that are going to be popping in and out. So, it's going to be a fun time. DJ, you're more than welcome to pop on with us if you have a few minutes. Just come on in and just be like, yo, can I jump on? Be like, hey, man, come on in. Yo, give us a few minutes. You're more than welcome. The invite's open, my friend.
Definitely.
All right.
You know what time it is.
That's it. It's JETS time. So, ladies and gentlemen, that's going to do it for tonight's Weapons Hot New York Jets fan broadcast here on the Worldwide Sports Radio Network, Sports War Radio, and Snowman Digital Media. And we leave you tonight, which still, in my opinion, is the best chant in the National Football League. All right. Peace, love, go Jets. We will catch you guys next week. Don't forget to check social media for Weapons Hot After Dark times, and as well, don't forget next week, 7 p.m. on the Worldwide Sports Radio Network. Weapons Hot will be here. Peace, love, go Jets. Be safe.
Get it. Good night, everybody.
The Worldwide Sports Radio Network. Radio Network.